Hi everyone, this is John here. I have been working in the IT industry for quite some time. I'd like to just share my knowledge about this topic, namely enterprise application integration. So let's get started on this topic. So what is this enterprise application integration is all about? Enterprise application integration, from the name itself, we can understand that it is mainly talks about integrating applications. So what is this enterprise? Enterprise is nothing but companies. Companies, they have their own, they have a collection of software, a collection of applications in their company premises, on-premises we call it. And those softwares all are inside the company, and those collection of software is, or the company itself, we call it as enterprise. So the enterprise application integration refers to the companies, inside the companies, how the applications are going to interact. So in this particular diagram, if you see, when we say applications, applications refers to the applications which are there in the TCP/IP layer, application layer, or the OSI layer, is whatever you're talking about. So this is again a concept of networking, which we have, which is there in the IT industry for quite some time, and this is very the basics of on which the entire IT industry is working on. So if you see in this one, applications are all in the application layer, and AI mainly concentrates on the integration of applications in the application layer. So the reason why this particular diagram has been brought out is because many people don't understand what kind of things, what AI is talking about, which kind of applications they are trying to integrate, what exactly they are related to. That is a picture many of the IT professionals or who was joining the IT industry, they generally don't get the concept. So that's the reason I brought this particular picture into for everyone's clarity. Okay. So whenever we want to have a communication between the applications, so what generally happens is applications from one end, which is running in one computer, and applications can also run in another computer. So they have to communicate between them. In that scenario, it would be climbing down this particular layers, and then it again it goes up. So if you see here, it climbs down and then it goes up. So this happens whenever a communication is happening between computers, which are applications are running in different computers. If the applications are running in the same computer, then the communication should be happening within the same layer itself, and it would be easier. So the main concept of this AI is addressing the kind of communication that are happening across computers, or in other words, across servers. So if you see, what are the common ways by which I can integrate applications? I can integrate applications which are running in different computers, right? Mainly by four different ways, four common integration styles, we can call it. So what are the four common integration styles? One is namely the file transfer. Second would be the shared database. Third would be the remote procedure invocation. And fourth is the messaging. So these are the four different styles or different ways by which applications residing different computers, this kind of communication is what is has been the industry has been using in the for quite some time. And out of these four methods, if you see, I have highlighted the popular method. The popular method is messaging. So if you say popular, most of the people prefer going for messaging, but it doesn't mean that other methods are not used. Other methods are still in use. Some places are still predominantly used because it makes sense in those particular scenarios. So the reason why these different integration styles are brought out is we should know that all are having its own importance, all integration styles, as they are important things in some places, and accordingly, as per the need, it has to be used. But predominantly, everyone goes for messaging. So when we are talking about applications, two different applications are there, and if you want to have the established communication between them, then comes immediately the concept of synchronous and asynchronous communications. So what is synchronous is So whenever application A, or in this scenario, you see here application A is there, it wants to communicate with application B. So when it wants to communicate, it will be sending the request to that particular application B, and the application A would be waiting for the response to come back. If you are waiting for a response to come back, then it is called as synchronous. Whereas if you don't wait for the response to come back, and if you proceed doing your other work, and once the response comes back, you take it and then you start working on it, then it is called as asynchronous. So just now we talked about namely the four styles, namely the file transfer, shared database, remote procedure invocation, and messaging. And if you see in this four message, this four integration styles, we can broadly categorize either as synchronous or asynchronous. So if you see here, synchronous, you are having the remote procedure invocation, it falls under synchronous category. Whereas if you take in case of asynchronous communication, here you'd be having the file transfer, messaging would be falling under that category. Whereas the shared database, a common database which is there, and that database, we can say it would be falling either synchronous or asynchronous. It depends upon how the applications use it. So the reason why it is, I have portrayed it in the middle is, suppose if one application A is trying to write it to a common database, and immediately second application is continuously listening for the changes that are happening, and if it pulls immediately, then it becomes a synchronous. Whereas if the application A is writing to a database, and if the application B, if it reads at the end of the day or the next day, in a frequency of 1 week, that kind of things, if it happens, then it becomes asynchronous. So it all depends upon how the application is entered. But you should understand that in shared database, I'm talking in shared database, it depends upon the applications, how they interact, that determines that particular shared database, synchronous or asynchronous. Whereas if you take in case of remote procedure invocation, it has to be synchronous. If you take a case of asynchronous communication, you can achieve synchronous, but it is also being followed in some places in the IT industry. For example, when you use messaging, via messaging, they try to achieve synchronous method, synchronous way of communication. That is also there, widely used in the industry. So asynchronous means generally file transfer, and messaging is what we talk about. Here I have given an example for synchronous. You take a phone and you want to talk to someone. You talk to someone, and after talking to that person, what happens is you hang the phone. So when you are talking to someone, someone else calls, right? No one would be able to talk to that particular person, or you also won't be able to talk. You have to put a hold on that particular person, make him to wait, and then go ahead and answer the other call. So you are consuming a lot of resources at that time. Whereas if a case of asynchronous, that is not the case. Example would be the WhatsApp. Whenever message comes, you whether the message is there or not, you are not going to read it. It would be waiting for you. And once you open it and read it, message would be available for you. So this is an example of asynchronous communication. So if you take in the world of integration, namely the enterprise application integration, that is, you're talking about applications which are sitting at the topmost layer of your TCP/IP protocol stack, that is in your application layer. And if you want to have the integration, so I can have these four different ways of integration I can achieve. So these four types of ways I can use to communicate from one application to another application. Yes, well and good, fine. How about if I have like hundreds and thousands of applications? So if I have thousands of applications are there, what would happen is each and every application, you have to keep on establishing connection to another application it wants to talk to. So this is what we call as point-to-point integration. So when you keep doing that method of following the method of point-to-point integration, what would happen is finally it would be kind of a mesh, or it would be looking like a spaghetti ball there, or you'd be a lot of wires running here and there between the company, or in other words, the enterprise. So this is what we call a point-to-point integration. It's very, very difficult to manage when the number of applications become more in number. If you are having like 5 or 6 applications, it makes sense. But it doesn't work out if the applications are very large. The application count becomes very large. So in order to overcome that came the concept of hub and spoke integration. In the hub and spoke, you would be having a centralized hub, which would be the heart of a particular integration. If applications are all would be sitting around that hub, and application A wants to communicate with another application B, it has to go via the hub. So hub and spoke is the preferred way of integration, which is used in the IT industry. So if you would be asking whether point and point, point to point is not used to be integrate, is not used in the IT industry. No, that's not the case. It is used in certain places, but it is not recommended. Okay, because if you are having a very small company, like you are having like three systems are there, and in that particular company you are having only just three systems, a point-to-point communication works well. But in a very big company, hub and spoke architecture is what being followed. So here in this particular diagram, here we are going to see about the hub and spoke methodology of integration, namely the EI integration. I just taken it. And if you have this EI, this particular EAI, okay, if you want EAI softwares, there are many softwares that are available down in the market. Just I given some few, just listed few softwares that are available, namely the IBM AppConnect Enterprise, that is the latest version that is available from IBM. Then we have MuleSoft, then we have TIBCO, like that, a lot of companies, every company, they have their own integration softwares available in the market. Well, if you take in this particular EAI world, I would say, when we are using this hub and spoke integration, okay, hub and spoke is what is preferred. So the time being, we will park point-to-point integration and keep it aside. When you see this particular hub and spoke, there are some important capabilities that hub and spoke, the CA software provides, and that is going to be the very key for having the communication between the applications. What are the capabilities that also has been listed out in this particular slide? One is routing. So when application A, for example, here you're having an application A, it wants to communicate with the application B. It has to communicate, means in that scenario, it has to go via this particular EA software, or rather the EA hub, which is there sitting in the middle, it will be going via that one. But there is another thing. So this one transaction, we can call it, or we can call it the event. It depends upon how we want to visualize it. Okay. Well, let's, for the simplicity's sake, let's take it as an event. Okay. So when a particular application generates the event, it has to transfer it to application B. What happens is it would be giving it to the AI, which is sitting in the middle, or EA software, or the hub, which is sitting in the middle. It will do that particular transfer of that particular event to application B. So this is what we call as routing. So this particular software, which is sitting in the middle, or the hub, which is sitting in the middle, its duty is to take care of routing. It has to ensure that that particular message coming from an application, it rightly reaches the target application. So this is routing. So whereas there is another important aspect here is when application A wants to send the message to application B, well, that's right, fine, it has to send it. If it has to send it, it will be sending it via in a particular data format. For example, in this example, in application A to application B, you see here, the application A can send messages or receive messages in XML form. Let's assume that one, okay? Whereas application B, it can receive and send messages only in the form of JSON. Whereas this particular messages, right, they are going to travel via the communication protocol, HTTP communication protocol, which is part of your TCP/IP top post application layer. HTTP is the application protocol. So via this communication protocol, this XML message is going to travel. Okay, fine. Whereas if you send that particular message as is to the application B, it won't be able to consume it because it accepts only JSON. So in that scenario, it is necessary that someone has to do the transformation, that is convert that particular XML message to a JSON message so that it will be useful for that application B to consume it. So that kind of transformation is what we call as data transformation. So data transformation who would be doing it? The person who is sitting in the middle, that is nothing but the hub. Hub will do that activity for us. So this is what we call as data transformation. This is one of the capabilities of the hub, or in other words, the EA softwares that are available in the market today. So this is this capability. These are readily available. You can take it and start using it. So there is one more transformation which I'd like to talk about. For example, let's take application C wants to communicate with application D. In that scenario, what happens is, let's see, here you're having again XML, so JSON. So this is what we call as data transformation. Just now we talked about it. So, and here, if you see here, in application C to application D, the application C can send the message only in HTTP format. Whereas HTTP communication protocol, whereas application D can receive it only via FTP protocol. If that scenario here, the protocols also are changing. So when this particular message has to be sent to D, it has to be sent via FTP as well as JSON. So you have to convert that particular message XML to JSON. That is, data transformation has to be done. And application C, when the HTTP message comes, it has to be transformed. That particular communication protocol has to be transformed from HTTP to FTP, and that FTP message, that FTP communication protocol, after doing it, then JSON message on the top of it, you change it and then send it to application B. So this is what we call as protocol transformation. So these are the two main important capabilities, I would say, which all the softwares which are available in the market today, they are having these capabilities, and it is really the core of this integration, I would say. So this is something that if you understand these two concepts well, you can understand all the forthcoming technologies, forthcoming concepts related to integration, which I'm going to talk about, you would be understanding it better. So here, I have just given some of the references for this particular integration world. What are the things that are some books and some websites are there. So these things, this particular topic mainly revolves around these topics, or in other words, these particular references. So if you have these materials handy, it will be very much useful to understand concepts better. So my recommendation is this book, whatever we are talking about, the EA patterns, or in other words, the enterprise integration patterns book. If you get a copy of it, it will be very much useful for your career in integration. Thank you very much for your timing. Have a nice day.